My point here is very clear. Pretty much everybody should have access to business intelligence and analytics to do the job that they're hired to do. And one of the ways that we would love to do this is pretty much by making it so intuitive that anybody can figure out what to do. So if you can pretty much just write whatever you want, click analysis, and then already you're starting to analyze the data that you have in your ERP system. This analysis that was generated on the fly is, of course, interactive. So I can start drilling into my data and doing whatever I feel like doing. Let's take it back one notch again. What we are really doing here is allowing everybody to navigate all the BI and analytics disciplines in a very coherent fashion. So what I do here is I can type a name that is recognized as a measure, and notice that in this case here, even though that I misspell revenue, it still finds the most appropriate measures and actions to do. Let me do a little more of a trick here. If I do say revenue, customer report, what it's saying is that I found both revenue, profit margin, profit, and customer and customer country. And the system is just asking me, well, could you please help me know if one of these measures should be used for grouping or not? And then, again, just on the fly, I create a report that is a pretty good offset for starting to analyze. So it's like we're really trying to make this so easy that everybody can start producing valuable content for them to start analyzing. And on top of this, we also have the ability to just search whatever was created already. In this case here, I see all the analysis and reports that are available that have something to do with revenue. So I can just choose to go in and say, I want to look at this particular analysis. In this case here, it's this is basic. This is classic target, I would say. This is stuff that we've been doing since 96. The ability to allow multiple objects to display data, allowing people to click, drill down. I want to, in this case here, perhaps sort on the budget variance. I want to look at this guy here, Vern, and so on and so on. I can then just work my way around in the data. So it's the basics, but all of those analyses are now possible to just do by searching for them or writing what you want. So anybody who doesn't think this is fairly easy, right? So anybody could do this. So that's like the main point. And my goal with all the stuff that I've been doing actually since the mid-80s have always been to try to make the power of computing very, very available. When I was first hired in what became Target, I made a programming language where I tried to make things easier for people just to write and then be able to program, because I saw that a lot of people had a little bit trouble with, say, COMAL 80, fairly unforgiving syntax, and so on. So by making something that's a little bit more intuitive, a little bit more forgiving, I believe that we can, you know, make it easier to use. And that's really what we did here, just within the field of business intelligence, within the field of dashboard reports and analysis. Now, some of the things that we can do here are even more powerful, because not only are we able to just create stuff from scratch in a very, very easy way, we're also able to kind of like move around between the traditional disciplines that we know when we're working with the analysis and reporting of our data. Let me give you an example. In this case here, we have this sales report. And I can just browse around in it. And of course, I can look at my numbers as we know it, like that. Or I can decide that I want to look at this particular negative growth in revenue. I care about that a lot. So now I want to dig down and figure out what is going on. So the system knows our preference. I was already looking at variances in budget on using this analysis. Now the system knows you probably want to look at that breakdown like that again. And by knowing what the user kind of intends, then we can allow the user to very easily move around between the different phases. And it makes a lot of sense, because if you have a report where there's an outlier that you don't understand what is, then you always, I mean, hopefully, if you're a company that doesn't make the same mistake over and over again, you need to be able to analyze to figure out what is the root cause of that outlier. And that is really what we're trying to do here in a very easy way. In this case here, we see that we have two places, and actually we have a negative revenue, and somebody is apparently giving money back to customers down here in Portugal. So now that I discovered this, I may want to say I actually want to be notified when if there's a variance. Either I could say if it's increasing or decreasing. In this case here, I just want to know if it's changing. And I can then, of course, set up more criteria than that. But if I'm happy with just knowing when something changed, I can just click once, and now I've scheduled an agent to monitor this outlier that I just detected. So in other words, I traveled a full cycle here in what we refer to as the action loop, which is also what you see here on screen. A phase where you observe against your data, you have an opinion about what should be. Typically, your opinion about what your revenue should be would be in your budget. So having a budget that you then continuously monitor reality against is probably what most people do. But then once something kicks out, when something is interesting or we need to do something about it, we go to the orientation phase and apply analytics. Like I said, hopefully, because if not, then we're just a company that does the same mistake over and over again. If we're never learning from our operations, we could just do away with just having reports. But my point is that most people don't really want that. I think that a lot of people would love to learn and then improve. And that's why you can really never figure out what's going on without having that, analytical bond between reports and analysis. And then once we go up, and of course we want to make a decision, that's a very human thing still in most systems, then we decide to do something about whatever we choose to do. We can schedule an agent to monitor. We can, of course, start sharing or sending to others, or we can set up storyboards, which I'm going to show you later on. But this process of working integrated with business intelligence is really the key here. And with this new version, we've managed to make it so intuitive that you pretty much just speak what you want, and then you get the output in the in Target. Now let me show you something a little bit different, because one thing is that we have data that are inside our ERP system. We know that sometimes the real world just happen. Sometimes there's just those ad hocs that needs to be done very fast in order to be relevant at all and to produce the right results. So in this case here, I've downloaded some data from the NAV posted invoices, and I just I can just show you. I just took them out here in Excel, and I can of course then decide to do whatever I want to do with it in Excel, or I could do something, in my opinion, slightly more enhanced. I could just drop it into what we call the Target Crossbone server, which is a high-performance analytical database that runs on the desktop and allows the data to be just swapped into memory. So now, if you look at it, when I launch my Target again, and I go into my data, I can also, instead of using the intuitive navigation, I can, of course, also navigate in a classical sense, right? But the data that I just took from this spreadsheet have now been loaded into Target it's actually already been mined, so to speak, to figure out what hierarchies are there, what measures can I build, and so on, and it's offering me a host of, filtering on the raw data or summarizing and counting and all that stuff. But in this case here, I want to be a little bit classic. I want to use one of the other intelligent features in Target, where pretty much to say, I want to add this as an object. And the first thing that Target will do is just say, when you add something, we just take a measure, I want to see it. Usually, you don't want the sum of everything of the entire world. Usually, you would at least want to use the time dimension as a component in this analysis. And I may choose to say, well, other than the time dimension, I also want to go in and look at the salesperson code and then add that. So now I can just add in objects as I see fit. I can, of course, go in and define even deeper if I'm not happy with the intelligence of the system. But the idea that you pretty much just ask for the actual business result you want, and the system creates as fast as possible based on the experience, is really what it's all about. And of course, these analyses here are completely interrelated already. So I can start doing interesting stuff here. I can start projecting the a forecast based on it. And of course, it's still interactive like this. So now already we're starting to work a little bit more constructive with this data that we just took out of NAV in this case and just dropped into the system. How about that? Has anybody ever had to import a spreadsheet in a system? Somebody? Does this seem easier than what you had to do? A little bit? Thank you. I need all the help I can get, honestly. So feel free, you know. Let's do some other fun stuff, because now I just drop data into the system. Let's start again where we left off and say, you know, I still want to look at my revenue. I also want to see my profit. And I also have some sales that I want to involve. And then I want to look at my customer again, something like this. And I want to create an analysis, as we saw before. But this time, I want to do something a little bit different, because I want to skip the detail stuff. And now I want to go in and create. As you recall, I was talking about like how you could just create stuff on the fly. And in this case, we also offer the traditional dragging and dropping. But this new design is way more, shall we say, Facebook-y, the idea of like tagging images and stuff. So I can just say, in this case, I want to add to this analysis. Look at that. Even Mr. Butterfingers gets the result with this here. I can just go in here and say, well, I want the period and the revenue. And then you see, I can then move around in the object just as much as I want in a define mode. Once I'm happy, I just hit OK. And again, we're just starting to analyze. I can go around and start drilling down and figure out, are there any interesting data here? So far, so good. This is pretty basic, though. Like being able to click one chart, the output reflecting in another. If you want to go deep in data, if you really want to visualize or explore data, then maybe you need a little bit more power. And I should mention that this is not for everybody. This is more if you're a little bit more analytical and you want something where you get stuff done faster, but also using a little bit higher power of analytics. But with Target, we have this option of, and this is actually a new thing we did, that we have the apps that kind of like surround Target. So you can just plug in an app for the high performance analytics server, the Crossbone. You could also plug in an app for the Target Timeliner, which is a visualization tool that allows you to do analytics very quickly. I have to just name the output that I want to get because it's an analysis I just created. But let's see. I want to look at the revenue. I also want to look at the profit and maybe the deal size that I have. So now I have like three dimensions over a timeline, just wanting to look at what are the data here. So first of all, maybe I want it just as a three-dimensional, where we have the revenue being the first axis, like going out there, the profit going up, and then the size of the dot is then how many sales needed to become that revenue and profit, so to speak. So now you know something about, like, if you have a dot very high up, you know, upwards, it's a very profitable deal. If you have a dot with going all the way to the right, from your perspective, it's a high revenue. And then if it's a small dot, you didn't really need to do that much to get that. And then you can probably work out the math on that. What I think is interesting here is that we've actually been demoing on this data set for long, but nobody really knew what I'm about to show you now. This just shows the power of visualizing data. Dig a little bit deep here. What we see here is actually that there's a very big difference in the data between, and I'm also, maybe I just want to go on the month view here just to get a little bit more spread. When I look at Europe up here, you see the data from Europe. What we do here is that we actually allowed, we get different from what you know from cubes, we can just take timelines and compare them to everything. It has some very interesting properties once you start involving external data and all that stuff. But let's not worry about that at this time. But in this case here, we see that we have Europe are the green dots up here that have high profit, high revenue, and some dots are bigger. And down here, we have Asia and United States. So one would actually wonder, I mean, how did we really let this happen? How come that we're not just like learning from Europe and doing what they're doing? So in this case, I would like to involve the time dimension a little bit more. Let's zoom in a little bit here. What you'll see is that Europe is actually moving, being very small, up and down, very inconsistent, whereas United States, with the yellow, is actually a little bit more consistent and performing, sometimes big, sometimes not, but not as bad as Europe. So in other words, what probably happened in this organization here is that the similar principle as like boiling a frog, that it's something that happens slowly over a time dimension, and then suddenly we just end up like 5 years later, stuff looking like this. So just to show you a little bit about that, we didn't know this, even though these were our demo data. We didn't know that there were such deeper, interesting things going on in the data. And I think that's so funny that people have been doing demos on these data sets for years and years, and nobody really knew this here. But that just goes to show a little bit of the power of visualizing differently, a little bit about the power of adding in some of the more, let's say, animations and 3D effect. Another thing that I think is kind of cool is this, and you have to bear with me a little bit, because now I'm actually going to do something interesting with some real data. Have any of you ever thought that when you look at your own ERP system, that there may be data out there that could also be valuable, like that could be added to and then help make better decisions? Somebody ever had that thought? Have anybody heard about the word big data or just social networks or whatever? I'm a strong believer in that if we could add to the value chain of information that we have in our organization, clearly the BI that runs on our ERP system is the most important thing. I don't think that's gonna change anytime soon. However, if we could know about what our customers are thinking before they even interact with us, or if we could get just an idea, so Or if we could get an idea about what our customers are saying about us after they bought something, I think that would add those extra 10% in our decision abilities that would then perhaps make us a little bit more successful than competition. So in this case here, I'm actually going online now. And then since this is a clothing store, I sell jeans, I sell underwear and shirts. Now let's see, I want to kind of like know a little bit about Nike products. So because I think that if people are Googling Nike a lot, then maybe if I take in Nike products, that means that there's people will have a preference and that can help lift my revenue. So those thoughts about just being able to take a data source on the internet and then integrate is also what we can do with the Timeliner. And this, in this case here, the Google Trends data and revenue. And it may not be that clear of a picture that you could see exactly, you know. But we still notice that the score for how many people are searching Nike here on Google is at an increase for the last years. And we could say that if the trend is not as much as our own revenue, why would we even bother? Why would we want Nike to drag our feet? But that's then a management decision. I'm just showing the perspective. Can anybody see this idea? That it could be kind of helpful, right? Kind of neat when you think about it. So those are actually like, I think, kind of a really interesting thing. Let me just show you also like the perspectives if we go a little bit more, because obviously once we start dealing with big data, there's a little bit more noise in them. So it's not necessarily that it will be a clear picture. But let me clarify a little bit though, because what I think is cool is that if we look at, for example, this trend here with Nike, and then maybe just go by month. Let's see then if we just forecast that and see how that works out. Okay, I just have to do that. I'm averaging everything, otherwise my calculations are not that good. Yeah, well, okay, I'm gonna skip that. Forgive me for that. What we can do is that we can actually send the data set to R, if you're familiar with that mathematical modeling language, and then we can get a reply back from R, and you can actually make your own formula, and then you can forecast on that to see what the trend is. I'll happily show everybody interested in using R down at our booth, but I don't wanna bother you with this. What I wanna bother you with is this here. Because there are more data than just the Google Trends data. That would be, for example, in Target, we also have a service where our customers can register keywords on Twitter and soon on Facebook as well, where we can kind of like monitor what is going on. So I want to do, I want to log in here with my demo. My demo user ID. And right now, we're monitoring this week the words within business intelligence. And probably it would be interesting to see what is the buzz about business intelligence here at Convergence. Some people are saying negative stuff, some people are saying positive stuff. And we can, of course, dig in as deep as we want, find the actual tweets. This system is intelligent, so it'll figure out which sentences are good or bad. It's not a perfect, it's not an exact science, so you also have to like look at it. For example, I know that some of the red tweets there are actually us talking about Target being reborn, coming out with completely new product, completely new visual identity. I can't see the bad thing in being reborn, but this particular sentiment analysis thought of that. But that's just one of the things. Again, as I said, once we start working with big data, there will be more noise. There will be more We won't have the same shields as many of you guys. If you work with IT already, then you'll be the shield that makes sure that nothing garbage comes in and it's all good data that you have internally. On big data, you don't have that option. You'll either have to take what is or maybe not at all. And then you'll have to kind of like deal with data quality on the fly. So that's just the price of magic, I guess. But let's just see in this case here, just take myself and figure out what's really going on with me. What are people saying month by month? So I'm just gonna do this here where I just look at only negative and positive. And in this case, we'll just see that over here, people were trashing me for some reason. I don't know what I did. But there was still more positive than negative tweets. Again, we have to then go in and discover which are which. But at least in this period here, this month, I feel the love. Again, imagine being able to do those things with your brand, with the products you have, and then join that. Does what is being said about you on Twitter correlate with your revenue? I mean, the possibilities are endless. And because Timeliner just effortlessly lets you join things on timelines, it's just a very valuable add-on only for like the top analytical users, I would say. But for those to be able to do this in conjunction with the data you already have, I believe there's a very interesting potential for that. So now, let's just say I want to look at something with revenue. This year is a let's say I care about revenue. I just want to communicate to everybody. What the system does is that it looks for revenue, of course, but I also have this so-called storyboard option where I pretty much show all the dashboards or analysis that I have with revenue. And I just have them run through as a slideshow. We use this in many ways where if you want to influence people in a certain area, let's say you have a production facility and you want to show the errors, the outliers, and how good the individual teams are doing, this is a very easy way. Since it's so easy to create the analysis, then you could just set up stuff that is personal to the individual team and then have that running on big screens. And this is how we use this here. So it's a way of saying, if we have something that we found out that we want to do with our company, then we can use these type of systems to, let's say, support the culture of quality, for example, or support the KPIs that we set out to make. So I also think this is a powerful feature, and I'm just showing it in the perspective of the intelligent wizard here. You could as well also say, I want this dashboard, and this dashboard has to be exactly like that. So of course you could do all that stuff too, but it's just a very easy way to do something where you pretty much just browse through whatever is relevant to you. So these here things were the stuff I wanted to show you. I'm jumping around a completely cool mobility client that we have. I would love to show that down on the booth. But other than that, at this time, I would like to give words to Dennis Deshe, who is actually head of our team that do all the accelerators. So pretty much Dennis is the person who will just plug in a system like this on whatever version of NAV and AX or GP that you may have, actually also CRM. So it's completely up to you. He'll be able to deliver that, and he's been doing so for more than 10 years, so this is not something we just came up with, say, 8 months ago or something. This is really stuff that is based, and actually, when we were doing this, working out of Microsoft in Copenhagen, after that knowledge transfer, where Dennis pretty much knew all about the tables, he was the person that Microsoft called to figure out who, where they put their data. So without drawing out anymore, I would love for Dennis to take over and just show you how to get all of this working with whatever systems you have.
Thank you, Morten. After this very interesting presentation, I'm now going to try to put you asleep with a bit of PowerPoint. Morten spared you that, so I'll have to be the one doing that. I just wanted to very briefly tell you about our commitment to the Dynamics products. As Morten mentioned, we've actually worked with standardized BI for Dynamics since 2002. We worked with BI for Dynamics even before that, but around 2002, we realized that every time we went to a Dynamics customer, we did a lot of the same stuff. So maybe we extracted the sales invoices at one site, and then we did it again on the next site, and again on the next site. So instead, we decided, well, why not standardize the BI part of the business as well? So we actually did that now for quite a few years. The standardized BI product we have is called Target BI Accelerator. We were also, for many years, part of Dynamics NAV. Maybe some of you know the business analytics product, which was continued in NAV 2013, when they decided that Excel would probably be a better BI client. We have some of the numbers of Dynamics customers. As you can see, it is a very large part of our BI clientele that are using Dynamics products. So now I'm apparently unable to change my slides. As Morten showed you, he showed you different approaches to working with data, and he showed you how you begin with your centralized business intelligence and then work with that data and start adding data from outside your company also. But your BI and analytics strategy always begins with centralized business intelligence. And the centralized part of the business intelligence is what we handle using BI accelerators. I don't know what we've achieved with this PowerPoint, but never mind. The centralized part, I have an overview of the architecture of Target right here. As Morten showed you, it's a client-server solution, and the part that we're now focusing on with the accelerators is the bit on the top left side, which is your central corporate data warehouse, on which you put your cubes, and then with the Target software on top. So I'm going to show you how we use BI accelerators to create this environment to prepare to do all the stuff that Morten just showed you. It's a very tricky way to use PowerPoint, but never mind that. Just very briefly, what is it we want to do with BI accelerators? Well, we want to choose the acceleration options that we need. We want to set up what are the options that we need to build the centralized solution. We want to run the acceleration process. And when that process has completed, we are ready to go ahead and start using Target BI and analytics. I'm going to talk a bit more about the technologies and more about what is the product actually. But first, I'm going to just start a demo for you. Then I don't have to use PowerPoint either, so that's probably better. The Target BI Accelerator, in this case, I'm using NAV version. If any of you would like to see the same product for AX, for GP, for CRM, please come see us at our booth, and I would be very happy to show you the live running of this product. The general idea is that I downloaded this from the Target website, and I'm now ready to start creating my BI for NAV solution. So I also already installed the Target software just to not waste your time with that. But basically, I now need to go and install and configure my Target system. Just, of course, read that carefully. Accelerator will just validate that we have all the software on the server that we need just to make sure that we don't hit a wall later on in installation because we're needing some component. As you can see here, as I will also discuss a little bit later, you can see that we rely on the SQL Server product stack for doing this installation. So we basically use SQL Server integration services and analysis services from Microsoft. I go next. In this step, I can download a 30-day free demo trial license if I would like to play around with the product. I already downloaded a license, so don't need to do that right now. I will go next. You can see all the steps that we need to complete in the accelerator. You can see those on the top, and a brief description of each step so you know what's going on. Our accelerator product supports all major versions of NAV, all the way going back to 2.6. So one use you could have of this system is actually you could use this to establish your centralized BI, establish this is now where I do my BI and reporting, and then you might not, you can upgrade your NAV and still have your warehouse in place and maybe not worry so much about new technologies for reporting inside your NAV system. But again, basically I need to choose a version. I want to show you the 2009 because I have a nice extended demo data set from Microsoft. So, but it also works for the latest NAV 2013, of course. I also need to specify if there are some of the standardized cubes that we offer that I do not want to include in the installation. So I basically say I would like, in this case, all the five major cube areas, so I would like data from finance, project, sales, supply chain management, and the CRM parts of NAV. I would like to include all those in my warehouse and in my cubes. I'll specify where to locate or where my NAV is located. So find the 2009 NAV version, and this will now list the different companies that are inside the NAV database. So this allows me to create a solution where I consolidate all data from all my companies into one warehouse and into one set of cubes, which I can then use for analysis and reporting, of course. I'll just stick to one company, go next. In the server environment, I might have different instances of SQL Server. So I just, again, need to specify what are the instances I want to use. So very quickly, I'll do that. I only have one. And also here, I specify that I would like new data to be pulled into my warehouse once a day, and that's at 2 o'clock at night. I can always use the standard SQL Server tools, the SQL Server agent tools, and so on to change this afterwards. Or if I want to pull data into my warehouse multiple times, I can just add schedules using the standardized SQL Server tools. The accelerator will now connect to the NAV database and check that all the tables and columns and so on that we need from that database to build the data warehouse successfully are in there. So if, for instance, I selected a different version of NAV than is actually the one I have, then you will probably get a less satisfying result than 100% in this step. But as I was pretty sure this was a 2009 database, I can see that I also get a 100% match for this. Finally, I have some advanced configuration options. Again, I don't have the time to spend a lot of energy describing those to you here, or I would like to use the energy, I don't have the time. So again, please come see us at the booth, booth 321, and I'll happily show you and walk you through all these options. But basically, I can go in and specify different things about how do I want my calendars or my time periods, which Morten showed you inside the product. If I use fiscal calendars and so on, I can specify that. I can specify different options around database naming. I have different options for how do I want to configure target. All these options are, of course, what we call sensible defaults. So if I just hit next now, I'll get a fully functioning solution with all the stuff inside it. But I can change a lot of these options if I choose to. The more interesting ones are that we, of course, pick up, in this case from NAV, we pick up what's the extra dimensions that are specified inside NAV for those of you who know NAV. So we can again select or deselect these dimensions according to the cubes that we install. So we again get that as part of the finished warehouse. And finally, I have options to go beyond what is inside the standard package. I can go in and specify if I want extra information about my different customer entities or item entities. We will connect directly to the NAV database, so any field or any column you have added to a nav, a custom column, or from a vertical module, you'll be able to select it in here and add it as attributes to the solution. So again, come down, see us, and I'll happily show you how it's done. It's very easy. It's a one-click approach to adding extra attributes to my different dimensions. And in much the same way, I'm also able to specify additional KPIs that I would like besides the one that come in the standard solution. But I'm just going to keep everything standard and click the next button. That's what it is. And now we see all these steps that need to be completed in order to install the target solution. In this demo data, it will take about 4 or 5 minutes to complete. So I'm just going to go back to my very successful PowerPoint presentation and show you a bit more, or discuss a little bit more about the technology behind this. We'll do the poor man's PowerPoint. BI Accelerators for Dynamics, as mentioned, it's all the Dynamics products that we have. We have NAV, AX, which are definitely the ones that we have the most installations on. And we also support GP and CRM in a product that pretty much looks like what I just showed you for NAV. But again, come see us and I'll show you. As I also mentioned, we rely on the SQL Server BI stack. We rely on SQL Server Standard Edition. Is a very important note to make that we do not require you to purchase a BI or Enterprise, a very expensive version of SQL Server. We'll do this on the Standard Edition. We'll utilize the UDM part of analysis services, which is the old-fashioned way to do analysis services, if you will, and integration services for doing all the ETL work, extracting the data, post-processing the data, applying business logic to the data, and so on. And we support these versions of SQL Server 5.8, 8R2, and 2012. So even if you already have a SQL Server in a 2005 version, you won't have to upgrade that to actually get started with Target. My last slide is just some of the headlines just to show you what I've been talking about. Well, BI Accelerators is out of the box, BI Analytics for Dynamics. We built a centralized data warehouse-based solution, so we rely on having all the data extracted into a data warehouse. The advantage of that is, of course, that it's very easy to continue working with this solution. We create project files so you can expand the warehouse we deliver using all the standard tools from Microsoft. So basically, the Visual Studio that you know, if you already know SQL Server, will be available to you. You'll be able to work with the SSIS packages. You'll be able to work with the database. You'll be able to work with the cubes. So it's the standard solution that you'll be able to expand on, put more data sources in there if you don't want to do it in the analytics approach that Morten showed you earlier. It comes with standard target analysis and reports. I'll show you just a very few, very simple examples of some of those when the installation completes. We have content for the 5 business areas that you saw before in Accelerator that you're able to select or deselect. And yeah, I already mentioned that you're able to use the standard SQL Server tools for doing your development. When you, at some point, if you reach beyond what the Accelerator will allow you to customize, you're able to go in and just, you know, do warehouse development, as some of you might already know how to do. So that was just the brief headlines, and now, of course, we need to wait this out. I think the average runtime for this is 4 minutes 30, so maybe I don't know where I'm going to do a bit of a dance, but I really wanted to run this to the end and just show you a few examples of the results that come from it. As you can see, you can recognize each of the steps that we discussed on technology. You can see we create the database, we install SSIS packages, configure those. We execute the SSIS package so we get data into the data warehouse while this is running so that we get to the part where we need to create the cubes. We already have data in there so we can optimize the cubes to the exact data of each solution. So this might be a process that might run for a couple of hours if you're run it on an actual customer installation. But again, we then optimize the cube for that particular data that is available in there. Yeah, now we're just doing the cube. Right now it's counting all that data I mentioned, so it can optimize the cube for the exact data set that we are extracting. So this will create that the base solution that Morten showed you, and when that's done, you'll be able to do all the cool stuff he showed you with the timeliner. You'll be able to use this data to combine it with the external data sources to see my business, the shared worldview that I create for my users, and you'll be able to combine that with external data from Google Stats or whatever. Any questions? Good time to ask for that. While this is running? Yeah. The rich client interface is only on the Windows platform, but you can have a web version which will run on any browser, on any system. Yeah. No. No, we won't pick it up directly, but you'll be able to, of course, reuse whatever you have in your Active Directory groups and then apply those to either on the cube level or on the target server level. Also, target also has a security model that you can apply to. Yeah. You can build your own security within the target part, or you can build your own security within the completed cube. You have those two options. You can build your new cubes, but as I mentioned, this is a centralized approach. So this is not something you would do on your own desktop. This is a solution that you'll install on a server. So if you wanted to change it, then it would be a change that you would then deploy to your server, because this part of Target is all about creating a corporate BI system. So it's not a desktop solution. But yeah.
If you have something you want to run just on your own server, on your own machine, or just share with a few other users, just build it real quick on the fly, just drop it in. You use the Crossbone server for those type of tasks. Because I kind of think that they are, the real world kind of like gives you both challenges, and we address both in either centralized or a local sharing type of way instead. So you have both, depending on your preference, actually.
Okay, so we're getting near the end of our time here, so I'll just very briefly, this now completed, so you can see in around 7 minutes, maybe I disturbed it a little too much, but never mind that. I will click the next button, and this is basically my solution ready for use. Oops. And I'm very sorry that this is a little bit of an older version of Target I have on this machine. So, not an older version. It's just the one, just a few builds before his. But the general idea is now that I now can go in and see I have now reports and analysis that came out of the box, and I can start looking at those reports and analysis and work with those. So I might want to open my customer development report, and I just need to find a few years back in this demo data. So you have out-of-the-box reports. Some of you might recognize some of these reports from what you can find in NAV. Some of the reports are styled or of the same type as the standard reports in there, but of course we then go in and add, you know, some of the different ways we can work with the data to signal when things go up, go down. And of course, you'll be able to do all the stuff that Morten showed you with these reports. You can click on the number and get sent further into further analysis. So we just basically have different reports and analysis ready for use in here right away. That was basically what I wanted to show you. I hope you have a bit of an idea of what we're trying to do. Again, please come see me at the booth. I'll happily show you more demos or show you demos for GP, CRM, or AX, or whatever you might want to see or know. So, back to Morten.
So, Dennis will be available for Q&A after this, but the main point here for us was to show you a very, very simple way of getting all the goodie bags put onto whatever system you have, and then, of course, open your eyes to the possibility of allowing users just intuitively ask the system, get catered with the reports and analysis, and then, of course, be able to make faster and better decisions for your company. I would like to put one additional layer to all of this. And this is really when we talk about Intarget, we talk about the courage to act. And the idea that if you have the right facts, then you're able to do the right things, of course, but it also means that if you have your own inner knowledge about how you're doing and where you are as an organization, that is allowing you to do the right things. And it's really a big problem for the human mind to remember. I used to say that we can only, some of us can't even remember what we have for breakfast, but then others can perhaps, remember good days only like 7 days back. The human mind actually starts to really tumble around if it has to remember. Try doing a grocery list for like seven or nine items and try to extend that every day you go and then see when you start getting in doubt. And of course, like trying to keep it in your head. But I like to say that we can only remember like 7 days back when we had a good or bad day, but we can remember almost indefinitely when somebody screwed us over, especially if you're a woman. It's a little joke, I didn't mean anything by it. But the idea that we could use the computer as an extended memory, an extended fact base that kind of like can gauge ourselves is really important. And just to show you the power of this, I think that some of the experiments we've done is like the human mind is, on the other hand, we remember poorly compared to a computer. On the other hand, we're extremely adaptable, like beyond almost understanding adaptable. I've done a lot of experiments with skydiving because that's a very isolated environment. We know exactly when people are going to be stressed, when they're going to really feel fear of dying. And then we're using facts to kind of like overcome that problem by telling about, well, it's safe, it works this way, and so on. We use facts to kind of like build up to go over that step that our mind is intuitively saying that we're not supposed to. The interesting thing is that we found by interviewing skydivers that a lot of people are have had the falling dream. Actually, 74% to be exact of all skydivers that we've interviewed had the dream of falling, and then prior to skydiving, by the way, prior to skydiving, having that dream, falling, waking up before you hit the ground. The interesting thing is that the more skydives you have, you actually start surviving that dream, and the dream continues. And that's just an interesting observation about like how something, and the reason I think it's so interesting is that we never tried falling and dying in this life anyway. So it's like nobody have tried that. So it's not an experience that we're reliving. It's our brain simulating falling and telling us that that's probably a bad idea. So we never tried that. But by repeating and showing the brain facts and examples of stuff working out, we actually managed to change something that was pre-programmed in the brain. So that's why I'm such a strong believer in the idea that if we can apply facts to whatever decisions we're doing, it's actually going to stimulate and unlearn, say, negative intuitive behavior that we are highly capable of as human beings. And that's to me, that's a very important point. So I was talking about business intelligence for NAV and AX, DP and CRM as well a little bit, and beyond. But I think the real beyond, aside from, of course, integrating with social media, big data in general, having all those additional options for visualizations, as I showed you, intuitive interfaces. But the real interesting thing is the human mind that we then apply to those systems that we build. And that, I think, is something to keep in mind. And that should be like the strongest motivation for us to run our companies at a completely different level than we did before. Just as an inspirational teaser, I have a little video to show you that kind of like sums it all up. And that's pretty much it. And then we'll have Q&A. It's impossible to get that hint away.